Okay, it's 14 April, grade 12, essential math. Yeah, when I get time, I sometimes put lessons on here. So this will just be like a daily thing. Once a week, maybe I'll get a chance to do this. Don't forget provincial exam, 15 June, for those who are on my course here in 2016. Next slide. Oh, next slide. All right. I always like to warm up with fractions. You know why. Someday your nephew's going to ask you. Not a very good example if you don't know how to do it. Now, the way I do fractions, I convert everything into pure fractions. All right. I'm sure you've learned other ways, and I've showed you other ways, but I do everything with pure fractions, right? This is like a counting number, and this is like a counting number divided by a counting. So this is like a, well, that's a fraction of a number, and that's a number. They're like different species. They're like elephants and giraffes. They're not the same thing. So I turn them all into the same thing, and then it's so much easier. So if you've got one whole pizza and then two-thirds of a pizza, isn't one pizza the same as three-thirds? So three-thirds and two-thirds is five-thirds, right? Three times one plus two is five. Same thing here, right? Eight times two is 16, so 16 eighths would be two pizzas. Add the three slices that you got, makes 19 eighths, so you get five-thirds and 19 eighths. Then you say, well, what number is common between 3 and an 8? Well, you know what? You'll never go wrong to multiply them. It might not be the lowest common, but at least it's common. So you cannot mess it up if you just multiply them. All right? 3 times 8 is 24. All right? I can make 24 with 8 threes, and I can make 24 with 3 eights. Isn't that amazing? All right? Now, doing that method may not give you the lowest common denominator, but then personally, who cares? It doesn't matter. Okay. Anyway, so of course, if I got 8 times as many in the bottom, I'm going to have 8 times as many in the top. That'll be 40. And if I got 3 times as many in the bottom, I'm going to have 3 times as many in the top. Right? You just got more of a smaller, more slices of a smaller slice. 97 24ths, well, let's see. 4 24ths is 96, and there's 1 24th left over. There you go. That's pretty easy. Or learn how to do it on your calculator. The answer's 4 and 1 24th, which works out to some weird number. Some weird repeating decimal number that goes on forever. Right, now the secret to dividing is to turn it into a multiply. Use my pure fractions method. You cannot screw up doing pure fractions. 4 times 6 plus 1 is 25 fourths. 3 times 9 is 27 plus 2 is 29. If you don't know your times tables, well, whatever. All right, so now the secret is you turn it into a multiply problem by flipping this one on the right. This is the divisor. This is the thing that's doing the subtracting repeatedly. This is the thing that is doing the dividing. So you flip it 3 over 29. That's called doing the reciprocal. So you flip it over like the reciprocal. And now it's the same as multiplying. So straight across the top, straight across the bottom, 75. And what's that going to be? 429, so it's going to be 80 and another 3,616. 75/116 is the answer. And I'm pretty sure you can't reduce that any lower, right? The button on your calculator could reduce it if it was reducible. And I'm pretty sure it isn't. Here's how I reduce. You ready? All right, so my favorite way to reduce is just to turn it into prime numbers. So 75 over 116, don't you know that a 75 is really 3 25s, and a 116, you could say, is 2 58s. Hold on, I can reduce this some more. So that's really 3 55s. Right, so it's really 3 times 5 times 5 in the top. Notice those are what you call prime numbers, and you can't reduce them anymore. And I notice that a 58 is divisible by 2, of course, because it's even. So it'll be 29 times 2 times the other 2. And notice that prime, like 29 is a prime number. It doesn't occur in the times table. So it turns out that nothing's going to cancel, so it turns out you can't reduce that. That's my favorite way of reducing fractions, by the way. I don't know what other people taught you, but this is the smart way to do it. It works for X's and Y's, too. So doing it this way is just way smart. Anyway, next slide. That's not even grade 11s, the 12s. Anyway, let's find the mean, median, and range. Well, you know what? This one's pretty easy. Check this out. Looks kind of symmetrical. Look, 5 below, 5 above, 15 below, 15 above, 20 below, 20 above. I'm thinking they're all going to cancel out, right? But 20 is going to cancel that negative 20. This 15 is going to cancel this negative 15. So don't you really just have like four zeros there? Because they're going to come, it's all zero. When you add it all up, it's all zero. So zero divided by anything is zero. So it works out the average is zero. And of course the median is right there. It's zero. And of course there's no mode. But the range is going to, oh, here's the range. Are you ready? How far apart are negative 20 and 20? The answer is 40. It's one of those pesky things where you're doing 20 take away a negative 20. Remember how subtracting negatives is the same as adding. I don't know about you, but anytime you take away something negative in my life got more. All right, let's try this one. When you add all these up, what's this? 75, negative 100, negative 105. So I got 105 negative things, and I've got, what have we got? 15, 35, 44 positive things. Looks like the negatives win, so I'm going to just find the difference and make it negative. So 105, 61, negative 61 in the top divided by the number of things is 8. And that's going to be awful darn close to 7 and 5 eighths, isn't it? Right. 7.62. Right. So it's 7 and 5 eighths the way I do it. The proper answer to that is 7 and 5 eighths. But I guess some of you like decimals instead. So you could call it 7 and 625 one thousandths, which is the proper way to say that, by the way. You're supposed to call this negative 7 and 625 one thousandths is the proper way to say that. You don't say 0.625. And, of course, I ask you to round to the nearest penny, usually. So since a 25 rounds up to the next number to 30, you'd round it up to there. Anyway, knowing how to round and knowing how to say numbers properly is not this great. All right, let's try this one. Your height is 163. There's 10 people in your class that are shorter than you. And your class has 24 people. And there's one other student that has the same height as you. What is your rank? Where would you fall on a line if you had like a line segment with 100 chunks on it? Where would you fall on the line? And of course you got a formula for that. So the rank, or the P rank, the prank. Okay, you take the number that are below you, you add half of the number of people that are the same, and then you divide all of that by the number of people. So plug in the numbers. And you know what? Don't go using a calculator if you don't need it, for God's sake. Right? So, gee, isn't this going to be 10 plus half of 2? Isn't half of a 2 1? Right? Isn't that going to be 11 divided by 24? Don't go using a calculator to calculate this. Oh, my goodness. That would be scary. And when you do the math, you end up with 45.83, but of course you're looking for your position on a line. Well, it's hard to be in the 45 and 83 one-hundredths of a position, because positions usually have whole number places. So you'd round that up to 46, and that way everybody would get the same answer. So you would be person 46 in a lineup of 100 people, if there was 100. And so you'd look something like that. Right, so if it went from 1 to 100, you'd be person 46. So you're just a little bit below the median or the 50th percentile person. Okay, that's easy. Eh? Next slide. Engage. Okay. Here's a problem to think about. So, of course, the way that I show you to solve these is to use the guess and check method. Algebra actually works much easier. Gaussian elimination or something. There's other ways to do it. But guess and check will always work. It might take you a long time if it's a weird answer, but it will always work. It's brute force. This is how computers solve problems. They guess 3 billion times and they check 3 billion times in 1 second. We're not quite that quick, but it will work, and especially if the teacher's being nice to you. Or you'll at least get really close. Right, so the first thing to do is come up with some secret code letters. Let's let B be the weight of the beaver. B's not the beaver, B is the weight of the beaver. The letter has to represent some value. W is the unknown weight of the Wolverine. All right. So now let's come up with, so we want to know the B. Let's calculate the B. And let's see. I like to take the easiest sentence. The easiest sentence says that when you add them, that the Wolverine is 5 more than a beaver. So to me, that means the Wolverine is the beaver's weight plus 5. There, that's a pretty easy sentence to say. So now let's start guessing. So I'm going to guess at 2. No, I'm going to guess at 20, which means the Wolverine is 25, right? Because you take the beaver, which we're guessing is 20, add 5 is 25. Now we check. So we're going to take 2 beavers and 1 Wolverine. So 2 beavers and 1 Wolverine, that looks like about 65 or so, doesn't it? Is it going to be 2 40s? And so does it equal 35? No, man, it's way off. So we wanted it to equal 35, so that doesn't work. So that's out of there. Let's try 15. All right, the weight of a beaver is 15, which means add 5, so the Wolverine must be 20. So 2 15s is 30, plus another 20 is 50. Is 50 the same as 35? No, but we're closer. We're getting closer. Let's try another one. Usually you get her by the third or fourth go. All right, let's guess at 10. All right, so we'll guess at 10. The Wolverine is 5 more than the beaver. Boom. So 15. So 2 10s and a 15. 2 10s and a 15. Hey, that works. That's 20 and 15 is 35. Happy face. Happy dance. Woohoo. So you just found the answer. And then it's nice if you give me a statement. How much does a Wolverine weigh? The Wolverine weighs 15 kilograms. Right. And then put a box around it so I don't have to go looking for it. Right. You get a little happy face from me. All right, let's try this one. Guess and check works, but you know what? Working backwards works nicely on this one, too. So let's work backwards on this problem here. All right, so 3 times x divided by 4, or 3 divided by 4 times x, doesn't matter how you say it, but 3x divided by 4 is 18. So let's see. You had a bunch of something, and you divided it by 4, and then you get 18. So let's work backwards. What was this before you divided it by 4? Well, before you divided it by 4, it must have been, it must have been 72, right? Because 72 divided by 4 would be 18. So before the divide by 4, this must have been 72. All right, so now you're going, okay, so what was the x before some moron tripled it? I don't want a triple x, so you're going to untriple. Well, untripling is called dividing, so you're going to divide it by 3. So before somebody multiplied it by 3, it must have been 24, because 3 times 24 is 72. So there's your answer, 24. Now, of course, you'd learn to use algebra, and the way you do algebra is you say, well, I don't want to multiply by 3, so you do a divide by 3. And you say, I don't want to multiply by 4, so you multiply by 4, right? And the top is a multiply. Notice how this and this will become 1, this and this will become 1, and you'll end up with 1x on this side. And, oh, you got to remember to do the same thing on this side, though. You multiply this by 4/3, so multiply this by 4/3. This is the algebra way of doing it. This is just the quicker way of thinking backwards. So you end up with 18 divided by 3 is 6 times the 4, right? Or 72 divided by 3 is the 4, 24. So there's the algebra way of doing it. You know what? Algebra is just thinking backwards, for goodness sake. It's just a little quicker. All right, let's solve this. All right, so this is actually a grade 9 problem. So what number do you plug in here so that 2 of some number plus 5 equals some that same number plus 12? So 2 of some number plus 5 is the same as that number plus 12. Well, you could guess and check, but let's not do that. Oh, no, let's do it. Let's do the guess and check. All right, so let's guess at an x, and let's calculate what the 2x plus 5 is, and let's calculate what the x plus 12 is, and find out when those two are the same. All right, so let's guess at 5. So 2 5s, 2 nickels, and a 5 is 15, and 5, and no, they're not the same, are they? Are they equal? No. So that's not right. How about 6? All right, 6, does that work? 2 6's plus a 5 is 17, yep, and then 6. So if we pretend the x is 6, 6 and 12 is 18. Oh, that's not the same, is it? Right, that's going to get... But they're close. We're trying to get them the same. They're almost the same. Let's try 7. All right, 2 7's plus a 5 is 19. And then a 7 plus a 12 is 19. Look, they're the same. And that's what we wanted to know. When are they the same? Woohoo! So it turns out plugging a 7 in there and there makes them the same, which is what we were asking for. And, of course, you should probably do the checking. You should always check your answer. And it does work, right? 2 7's is 14 plus 5 is 19. And a 7 plus a 12 is a 19. So it does check. Woohoo. Now, the other way you can do it, of course, is using grade 9 algebra. So it goes like this. Just watch. Right, you write it out. You're going to muck around with both sides. So I divide both sides with a dotted line. So I'm going to take away x from here, take away x. Did I do the same thing on both sides? Yes. All right, so that's what's the result. All right, so I had two x's, take away one x is one x here, plus 5 on this side. Oh, the x disappeared here because I took it away. Oh, my goodness. Now, I want to get x by itself, so if I take away 5 to get rid of this 5, then I got to take away 5 from both sides. If you do the same thing to both sides, you cannot screw up algebra. And what does that leave me? Oh, well, you took away the 5, so you're just left with the... Oh, look, on this left side, you're just left with the x. And it means that the x is 7. So the x must have been 7 before you mucked around with all that stuff. And don't forget to check your answer. Plug it in. 2 7's plus 5, is that equal to 7 plus 12? Let's see. 2 7's plus a 5, please, is it? Question mark, equal to 7 plus 12. It is. Woohoo. Happy face. Where's my happy face? There we go. Anyway, don't forget to do the checking phase, because that's how you tell whether you got it right or not. Next slide. Oh, and of course, this is why we learned how to graph things in grade 11. Check it out. So, if you don't like algebra, you can solve every problem by graphing it. In fact, you can solve more problems by graphing than you can with algebra. There are some problems algebra won't do. All right, So let's graph it. So if you remember how to graph 2x plus 5, here's what it looks like. Well, we'll just race through this because there you go. Here's what it looks like. This is grade 11 stuff. Although in grade 11, we didn't use it to do algebra. We just graphed the lines in grade 11. So the question is, when does the green line equal the blue line? Well, it looks like it equals there, right? 1 to the 4, 5, 6, 7. 1 to the 4, 5, 6, 7, 19. That's 7, 19. So in other words, when the x is 7, the y is 19 for both lines. So that's telling you that when the x is 7, they both equal 19. All right. So if you don't like doing algebra, just go back to your grade 11 and figure out how to graph things, because it works nicely too. Next slide, the quiz. We did the quiz. Next slide. Okay, then we did some vehicle finance. So, all right, so after the quiz, which was pretty good, I think. Most people did well on that. Let's check out vehicle finance. Next slide. All right, so here's how you calculate the price of things, the price of a car. And I told you about how when we bought our car there, me and my buddies, we all bought the same car. So 25 of us went to a dealer in Toronto, and we bought a Toyota Celica. Oh, I skipped one here, didn't I? All right, so there's Jesse wants to buy his car. All right, so you can read all that. Don't laugh about the El Camino and the Pinto. Right? If you check those out on the internet, they were kind of nasty, ugly cars. In fact, the Pinto used to blow up if you hit it from behind. In any event, so what are you going to pay for your car? All right, so you got to buy the car, plus you want the extra fancy hubcaps or whatever for $526. And the car's not on the lot, so they got to put it on a train and bring it from Toronto, so, or Oakville, I guess. And so it's going to cost that much. So there, those three numbers added together. Total comes to $19,366. And they say, tell you what, we'll give you $1,000 for your car. So it's going to be 19,366 less than 1,000. So that's how much they say they want from you, but of course you got to do the PST and taxes. So add the taxes. Now the easiest way to add taxes is to multiply by 1.13. And of course what that gives you is $20,753.58 total, right? So that's how I calculate the taxes, right there. Right, so I didn't actually calculate what the taxes were there. Well, let's have a look at them on this one. All right, so there you are buying a Toyota Celica. Yeah, me and my buddies, 25 of us, went and bought the Toyota Celica back in, I won't tell you what year. It was a 1976, 25 of us went and bought them. I think I paid $7,000 for mine back then. And I think I got a $2,000 discount because we bought 25 of them. Anyway, you're going to be charged $600 for freight. It's got to get here from Toronto. She wants the pretty pink mat and the CD changer, even though they don't make them with CDs anymore. And she wants the pretty pink splash guards. And, oh, she must have a pretty newish car. They're going to give her $3,000 for her car. All right. So what is it going to cost her? All right. Well, let's do this. It's $35,280 plus all the options and the freight. And the mats and the CD thing and the splash guard. So that comes to $36,700 or whatever there. You can do that. Now they give her $3,000 for her old car. So there's $3,000. So subtract, that's what less means. Subtract, so that gives $33,766. And then let's calculate the, well, you know what? I skipped calculating the taxes. I just went straight to the purchase price by multiplying by 1.13. That's the smart way to do it. However, if you wanted to know what the taxes were, you'd have to do that. And then the tax part is the 0.13 part. So the taxes on that car is $4,500. All right. So that part there is the tax part, and that's the original part. So that's why you multiply by 1 and 13 one-hundredths. Next slide. And then we did a practice one here. So this is Bravo 1, assignment Bravo 1, engage. All right, so here's how you do that. Total cost. That's with all the options, I guess. And then you got to include the taxes. So the total cost includes taxes, by the way. So that's $48,691.70. Don't forget to drop the extra zero on the end there, like put it on. So how much do you take for a loan? Well, guess what? They don't give you money for the full amount. You got to show them that you can at least afford part of the car. So you give them $3,000 up front. So you go to the bank and say, hey, bank, I got to pay this amount. I paid $3,000 already. So can you loan me the rest? So $45,691 or so. And the bank says, sure, we'll loan you money at 6% for 4 years. So let's calculate the monthly payment. So there's how much you need to borrow from the bank. So your monthly payment is going to be $23.49. Not, right? That's $23.49 per, oh, yeah, do I have it there? $23.49 per thousand. All right, you'd have to read the chart. So it's $23.49 per thousand that you borrow. And how many thousands did you borrow? Well, it looks like you borrowed about 45 and a bit thousand. So you're not done yet. So you got to take how many thousands? Well, it's there's how you calculate how many thousands. How many thousands? So it's going to be 23 times 45 and a bit. You're up around 1,000 or so. Turns out to be $1,073.30 monthly payments. Oh, my goodness. My mortgage is half of that. For my house. All right, so now what do you pay for that car at the end of 4 years? So it's that amount per month. Notice I'm putting the units. Now 4 years, don't multiply by four. You can't cancel out months by multiplying by years. You got to multiply by 48 months because 4 years is four bunches of 12. All right, there you go. So you end up paying the bank $51,518 for your $45,691. But don't forget, you actually paid $3,000 when you first started. So you still got to pay that too. Uh, All right, so where'd we get to there? So don't forget, you still got to add back the $3,000 if you want to know the total price of your car. So you must have paid that to the bank plus the $3,000 you put down originally. So your $54,518.40 is what you paid overall for a car that had a sticker price of $43,000. And don't forget, of course, you need tires every year, goes for maintenance every year. You still got to buy insurance. Insurance is like $1,400 a year. And oil changes and new windscreen wipers. And it's not cheap to own a car. You can buy a lot of bus passes for that amount of money. Next slide. All right, let's try this one. Here's Rob enjoying his summer day or whatever, spring weather. He goes to buy a Mustang. So there you go. His total cost by the time he applies the taxes is that. All right, I just multiplied by 1.13. The amount of the loan. Well, of course, he's got to pay a little bit down. The bank doesn't usually give you money for the entire thing. So he take away $2,050, leaves you that. So he goes to the bank, says, can you loan me that amount of money, please? And they say, yep, we're familiar with you. We know that you pay all your debts on time, so we'll give you a really good rate, 7.5%. And so you go, so how much is that going to cost me, 7.5%? Well, it turns out your monthly payment, right, you got to check here. Turns out it's going to be $991.61. All right, let's try that, $991.61, because we said 7.5%, so you got to find halfway in between. So halfway in between is, here's how I find halfway in between. I add them together and divide by 2. So you got to pay $31.11 per thousand that you borrow every month. So $31.11 for every thousand. So it's 32,000 divided. So there's 32 and a bit thousands times the 31.11 for every thousand. And it works out to be $999, pretty much $1,000. All right, so when you do all that fancy math, you end up with $1,000 there-ish, $991.61. Okay, you can do all this. It's pretty easy math. There you go. And you know what? When we get to the how to buy a house, you're going to be using exactly the same kind of steps. You're just going to use bigger numbers. All right, it's kind of boring, this kind of stuff. I'd rather get into the geometry. Oh, well, that was exciting. All right, so you can finish Bravo 1. How to buy a car, how to do percents, how to subtract numbers and add numbers. Oh, my goodness. This is way funner, this stuff. All right. Briefing.